Hello and welcome to Coming Attractions, coming to you pre-recorded from the Annie Dome. With me as always is Dan and Joe. How are you guys?
I'm top of the world. How's yourself, Nick?
I'm all right. I'm hanging in there.
Lovely.
Nick's had a bit of a boo-boo, but he's going to be okay. And that's what I love about Coming Attractions, you know. We play through the pain.
We're professionals to some extent. This week, we're talking about the new Mel Gibson film, Hacksaw Ridge, which we've all seen.
It is a momentous occasion on Coming Attractions. We've actually all seen a film we're going to discuss. And perhaps more importantly, Dan's seen a film that we're going to discuss.
Want to throw a big my bad out there, I guess, at the end of the day. Look, love films. Sometimes I just don't quite get to them. So, it is what it is, I suppose. Let's talk a little bit about Hacksaw Ridge. Hacksaw Ridge tells the true story of Desmond Doss, a devout seven-day Adventist who enlists to serve in World War II, despite being a conscious objector.
Conscientious.
Let's try that again. Hacksaw Ridge tells the true story of Desmond Doss, a devout seven-day Adventist who enlists to serve in World War II, despite being a conscientious objector who refuses to use a gun or take a life. Doss, played by Andrew Garfield, runs into trouble the moment he walks into boot camp with his sergeant, played by Vince Vaughn, the captain of the battalion, played by Sam Worthington, and the rest of Doss's squad, convinced he's a coward who will be a liability on the battlefield. Doss and his comrades are eventually deployed to Hacksaw Ridge, as the film's title suggests, a gritty maze of battlefield trenches in Okinawa in 1945. It leaves Doss with the ultimate test of courage and religious resolve. What did you guys think?
Well, where do you start? I mean, it's a film of two halves, and it's worth pointing out. The first half is this fairly corny romance surrounding Doss and his love interest, played by Teresa Palmer. Then the second half is when they get to Hacksaw Ridge, as the name would suggest, and it turns into an incredibly violent war movie, beautifully staged, but it's an interesting film, and for that reason, I think the war aspects are far stronger than the romance aspects. So that was my impression of it. It also, it's a typical Mel Gibson hero. He's very selfless. He's not particularly complex. You know, you figure him out pretty quickly in the movie, and he maintains this selflessness and this religious sort of thread that he has. And you can compare him to the other sort of heroes of the films directed by Mel Gibson, from Jesus Christ to, of course, William Wallace and Jaguar Paw from Apocalypto. They're all heroes who are put through immense adversity and, you know, come out on top in some respects. So, yeah, I've got mixed feelings about the film. What did you think, Joe?
Like you say, very much a film of two halves. And I almost felt as though it was thirds, you know. You've got the initial... It was a sappy romance tale, and it wasn't well written. And given that wasn't a great script to work with, I think the actors did the best they could, but that's not to say they did very well. And then you go into, as is the standard now for any war film, they need to do the boot camp scene, which becomes this sort of eventually leads to the courtroom drama. And then the second half is just relentless blood and mayhem. And I think if you didn't know it was a Mel Gibson film, if you went in with no other understanding than conscientious objector in World War II, the first half would have had you sort of, well, it just does not prepare you for the second half. That would be the best way to put it, I think. Dan?
It certainly polarizes you. The jump point, I guess, from their arrival in Okinawa and then everything that happens beforehand, you know, it's a bit of a sleepy drama to a degree. And then the change of tempo is intense. That's the way I would describe it. And it's fairly relentless in the way in which it rolls out as well. You see a staggering amount of violence in those scenes as well. And it doesn't really stop either. And that makes sense as well. You know, you know, the character that Andrew Garfield plays is a field medic, and he's, you know, obviously going to see quite a lot of violence as far as, you know, the people he has to treat. But gosh, there's just, I know the any World War II epic that we see has a focal point as far as the gritty realism regarding the death count that exists and the way in which people die.
Well, in this post Saving Private Ryan world, I think Spielberg changed the whole genre when he filmed Saving Private Ryan, and suddenly it wasn't, oh, you know, bang, I got the baddie. It's bang, and I got the baddie through this point, and then you see the exit wound, and then the guts splatter everywhere, and Mel took it and ran with it.
There's a couple of scenes when they get to Hacksaw Ridge and they're on the battlefield, and there's actually a shot of soldiers' feet, and they're running through, and you can just see the ground, and it's human entrails, it's people's faces blown off. It's a pretty harrowing account of what's going on, and I do understand why they do this. Like, it does make a lot of sense. Mel obviously is trying to present the seriousness of this war and the faceless masses that had to die in order for the war to end, as many of these films have done as well. It's pretty intense to see, though. There's a lot of, I would nearly call it hyper-violence in the way in which it rolls out. There's a lot of stuff there where I feel like the point was made and it just kind of kept going. Did you guys feel the same?
Yeah. I mean, Gibson has said that he wanted to make it very clear what these guys went through. And yeah, it is relentless. I mean, he would argue that he was building the atmosphere of what it was like to be there and the absolute carnage and mayhem that would have unfolded upon these guys. So is it excessive? Yes, but like I said, something that's hard to argue in a war movie. You know, is the violence excessive? How do you imply it and still have the same impact? I think he did a very strong job of building that dread. I mean, for me, the key scene was when the trucks of the piled bodies are coming down from the Hacksaw Ridge.
Yeah.
And the fresh faces are just watching these trucks come past full of bodies and like, all right, that's where we're going, you know. And that scene, like, I felt this, you know, dread in my stomach. It was pretty heavy going. And then, like you said, those incredible shots of the feet stepping over all this detritus, and it's like they've just crossed the River Styx. And there's this bodies and there's rats eating the bodies and everything.
Yeah, yeah. There was that one humans. Scene with the maggots coming out of the guy's face.
Yeah,
and
yeah. It's actually a lot.
There's a scene in the, I believe, where they've bunkered down for the night, and they assume that Japanese forces are moving in during the night to try and catch them unawares. And it's actually a bunch of rats just eating a dead body. And it does hammer it home. It's an interesting, I don't know, I just kind of got to the point where I felt like I'd had my fill with the way in which it was going. And a lot of the scenes, for a film that has Andrew Garfield as the lead, I felt like there was a lot of scenes that had him removed from that as well. It made a lot more sense moving down the line as far as the runtime of the film. Like, he returned and then had a very big part in the final third of the film. But there is a lot of parts which felt to me like senseless violence for the sake of it being there to create a set piece. And I felt like they'd already hammered home the notion that, you know, war is violent.
If we're going to take it purely from an entertainment perspective, and suddenly sounds really cheap from the guy who's wearing the military shirt, soldier in the war on terror, people. The thing about it is, if you're just going to the movies to be entertained, Mel Gibson does violence in a way that I think is more original and more thought-provoking and better thought through than almost any director in Hollywood. You watch, I mean, obviously they're very, very different films, but the first Superman film of the most recent reboot, Man of Steel, their version of violence was, I punch you, you punch me, I punch you, you punch me. And it just went on and on and on. And I'm like, I don't know.
It felt lazy.
It was really, really lazy. Yeah. Mel finds new and interesting ways for you to go, oh my God. And in every film, and he did it in this one, there's a very, I mean, it stuck out in my mind, the moment where they picks up a carcass and uses it as a human shield. And I was like, Well, I mean, I've seen Human Shields before, but not like this. And
it felt a bit Michael Bay to me in a lot of ways. Like, if the body had exploded at that stage, I would have been like, all right, well, maybe is he an EP here? It's possible.
But what did you guys think about Doss as a hero? Because for me, you know, he's the center point of the movie. He's the emotional thrust. He's the whole point of the film to a large extent. I mean, obviously, this is based on a real guy, and I'm sure it's quite truthful to who this guy was. But as a hero in a movie, is he interesting enough to really sustain, you know, a 2-hour film? I found his angelic nature, you know, a little bit two-dimensional, to be honest with you. I mean, was there any dark side to this guy?
I would say one-dimensional, to be honest with you. And they just hammered that home in a really, really big way. And I don't know. You knew what you were in for. They weren't going to give the dark side of this character, because that's not what it was about. And they tried to use the ensemble cast to build up, I guess, the animosity that comes out of people that are put in that theater of war, and they see things and they know what they're in for, or they don't know what they're in for, and it changes the landscape of human interaction, I guess, inside of these films. And he is that beacon of light that exists inside of that. And it's a shame that they did that, because at the end of the day, the film, by and large, is based on conviction and based on having a belief and having an unwavering belief as well. And whilst there are scenes where Garfield's character doubts his beliefs, you don't see him lash out, even though they hint at it through flashbacks and things like that.
He overcomes his disbelief in about 2 seconds.
Yeah.
What do I do, God? Oh, gotcha.
What I've enlisted to do.
Yeah.
Okay, sweet. Yeah. I'm back on board. Yeah.
Well, like, I can tell you that the parallels to Jesus Christ would not have been lost on Mel at all. I mean, this guy is a martyr, essentially, you know, and he, even to the point of healing the sick, you know, he is a Jesus figure.
I hate to say it as well. We don't like to add spoilers, and I don't think this gives anything away, though. There is a scene in the film where he's doing what I would argue is some fairly superhuman things. And that's, look, and I don't want to take anything away from Doss as a man as well. You know, like, he saved 75 people at Hacksaw Ridge during that particular conflict, and it's an incredible feat. But there's a bit in the film where he's patting grenades away with his hands. And I just couldn't help but go, it's unnecessary.
Yeah, he didn't need to do
this. He's an amazing human being for being an amazing human being. You don't have to give him these quasi-angelic abilities for me to believe that. I already do. And I just felt like overkill. I didn't like the fact that they went that way with it, because it wasn't needed.
Well, I felt the whole finale was unnecessary. It got to a point where I went, you could roll credits at this point, and I would have sort of said, yeah, this is a satisfying ending. And it's funny, you watch a war film that's based on, you know, on a true story, and you know that it's going to have that end bit where it goes, here's what happened afterwards. The following people had the following lives. You know who wins the Battle of Okinawa? Like, it's not, there's no part about what happens in this sort of final, I guess, almost 10% of the film where you go, oh, there's been so many revelations. It was this unnecessary part. And that's when it really strayed into what I would think was a little bit ridiculous. And it had gone from cheesy to be honest, a little bit stale, to suddenly this heightened, crazy violence that I was actually quite impressed with. I thought as a war film, it was right up there. That second part of it up until the ending, and then I went, that was just fell flat.
It reminded me a bit of Fury, and the idea of the futility of war and the casualties that exist, the faceless casualties that exist inside of a theater of war like that. Let's speak a little bit briefly about the performances inside of the film. There was a couple of big name actors there, a very large Australian cast actually as well.
It's technically an Australian film, which, you know, it means you need to have X amount of cast and crew be Australian. And as with any of these Australian films, it means that you've got a big name actor and then you can fill in your gaps with Aussies. But to be fair, the crew were largely Australian, and we're still calling Mel one of ours. So yep, the Aussies are in. Andrew Garfield, I felt he carried the film. He was all right. But he was all right. That's all.
He was, I guess, cutesy enough to play the character.
He kind of felt a little bit like a more cerebral Forrest Gump to me.
Mm.
Is that a weird thing to say? But maybe just
I kept thinking of that.
He only had so many, his ideals were the basis of the character, and he became so one-dimensional that I'm not trying to take anything away from Forrest Gump, but he had...
No, every time he went charging back in, I kept hearing in my ears, I gotta save Bubba.
That's it. I mean, and there was a couple of other big name Australian actors, actresses there. Hugo Weaving was there, played his father, who was like a grizzled war veteran who had become an alcoholic, quasi-abusive, that just had really felt... I guess the throes of war.
Rachel Griffiths was in there. Mm-hmm. We had Richard Roxburgh pop up for a little bit. Obviously, Sam Worthington was he got second billing on it.
Ferris Durrani as well.
Ferris Durrani.
Matt Nable. It was like spot the Aussie, basically. Yeah.
Let's cut to brass tacks. Dan, what did you think of the film overall? What would you give it as a rating?
To be honest with you, I enjoyed it at the cinema. I wouldn't recommend it to anyone, I suppose. I wouldn't say you need to go and see this film. I had fun with it, but I just felt like it was missing elements, and it felt like religious propaganda by the end. That's what I would say. And it took away a little bit from what the film perhaps should have been. I feel like the story of a man who saves countless people purely pushing away all adversity until he gets to that point where he's actually in the theaters of war and it's just there to save people, and everyone told him that he wasn't able to do that without a weapon. I just think it was lost, I guess, in some of the back end of the film. I feel like the first third of the film as well was a bit lackluster. The romance elements didn't exist. I'd give it 2.5 stars.
I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. I saw all the weaknesses, and they were glaring. But overall, I also went in going, this is a Mel Gibson film. I know what to expect. Mel Gibson's been making these films for 20 years. I'm up for it. I'm keen. I'm a Mel fan. Sign me up. And I got what I hoped for. I was not left disappointed. I'd give it 3 stars.
Yeah, I think I'd recommend seeing it on the strength of the battle sequences. They were really well staged. On the big screen, I was squirming in my seat, to be honest. I was ducking bullets. And
I had an actual one of those, like, oh!
Yeah, yeah.
I was with him, and he nearly knocked the popcorn over. I would have been filthy.
I mean, unforgivable. And look, I'm just going to put it out there that Hugo Weaving, possible Oscar nod for his role. Putting it out there.
Please.
I thought he was exceptional.
Visually, he was great, but he didn't hold his American accent, which is so odd because I've seen him do it before. I mean, specifically in the Matrix trilogy, he did it. So, like, the fact that he couldn't nail it, like, was there too many Aussies around and it just threw him? I don't know.
To be honest, you know, I didn't really notice the accent at all. I thought he did hold it together. But so we'll have to differ. But look, I thought it was definitely the best performance in the movie for mine. And so I was pretty impressed by him. Overall, I would also give it 3 out of 5.
Be sure to stay tuned for part 2.
Welcome back to Coming Attractions, the podcast hosted by portly men for other portly men. Look,
portly women too.
We don't discriminate here.
Of course not.
We were talking about Andrew Garfield before in Hacksaw Ridge. Interesting that now we segue into the new clip for Spider-Man Homecoming. Obviously, he's no longer on board. We have Tom Holland coming in, a relative unknown as Peter Parker / Spider-Man, coming on board for the first new feature-length Spider-Man film, now with added Marvel goodness. We've seen the trailer. What do we think?
Honestly, I was very jaded, I think, after having seen the Garfield Spider-Man, which, tell you what, that's a crossover that we need to have in the Sunday comics. But after, I just wasn't ready for it. I mean, it would be the third version of Spider-Man in what is less than 20 years, and I just was very jaded on the prospect, and I wasn't fussed. And then I saw the clip, and it looks punchy. It looks fun. It looks fun.
It feels like the most Disney version of any Marvel comic book franchise film that I've seen. And I thought of The Lion King straight away. And I know that seems like a weird parallel to run here, but like
It feels as though the world is well in Spider-Man's world. However, something's about to happen that's going to really rock that world and make him judge and be worried about where his place is and whether or not he can stand up to some ominous force that exists. Kind of feels like Simba, you know, like it kind of, I'm getting that vibe, or pretty much anyone else has ever rolled through when, you know, a Disney film's come out. And you know what? That might not be a bad thing. I think it, this is a teenage...
It's a classic storyline.
And it's a teenage character that's trying to find his place in the superhero world. And I feel like the tone, at least off the back of the first official trailer, is pushing that. And I think that's not a bad thing. What did you think, Nick?
Look, I'm still not sold. I don't think I'm really ready for a third Spider-Man. To me, it seemed pretty similar to the last two franchises in tone. I mean, going on the trailer. So I guess I'm waiting to hear a good reason as to why I should be suddenly investing in yet another Spider-Man franchise. Obviously, Iron Man's in it, and we've sort of already established this new Peter Parker in Civil War. But yeah, I'm not excited. I'll keep an open mind, but a third franchise, yeah, there has to be a good reason to be investing in this again for me.
There is a good reason. Spider-Man's the most likable Marvel character. Whether or not you guys feel that way off the back of the movies, it doesn't really matter for me anyway. I grew up reading the comics, and I can say this to you, knowing a variety of different Marvel characters. When done well, he's the most relatable character. He has a job. He has a girlfriend that sometimes likes him, sometimes doesn't. He has responsibilities to balance. He also happens to have these incredible powers, and he has to work them into his life. He has to figure out the balance that exists there. And a lot of the time, it ruins everything for him. And I like that they're starting at this point where he's in school. And whilst when you had the original Spider-Man trilogy that came out, it kind of did that. It didn't really. It was there for 20 minutes and then it left. You know, it wasn't important about like, oh, how hard is it to balance your books and then, you know, also fight these juggernaut supervillains. It feels like it's going that way. And it feels like it's the trepidation that exists between not really knowing your powers, having that teenage bravado that exists with having the powers as well, and figuring out what you can and cannot do. And I want that. I want that from a Spider-Man character, and I want that character to grow. And I feel like it's certainly, the platform is there now.
Do you know what I am not excited by? And this is going to sound very, like I'm being a dick, but I'm glad that Uncle Ben is not going to be a factor in it, because we've already seen that Uncle Ben dies and that it's really sad, and it's what motivates Peter Parker to become Spider-Man. And I've seen it played out twice, and both times it kind of happened in the same way. I don't need to see it a third time. Uncle Ben has passed away. I'm sure there'll be a scene between Spider-Man and Aunt May where he, you know, talks about how he misses Uncle Ben, and you know, it'll be a lovely scene.
It's a different kettle of fish now, though, as well. Like,
you just don't need to see it for a third time. That's all.
Marissa Tomei playing Aunt May now. Yeah, as well. Like they've mixed it up in a pretty big way. And maybe they're lucky in a lot of ways that origin element has been covered twice. They don't have to go back on that. And, you know, people that come into watch Spider-Man Homecoming know that as well. And what that gives is a lot of creative license for other elements of Parker's life, which I think have been, you know, they've seldom touched on. You know, like, he's a kid, you know, and that's what's going to make it good. You know, like, we watch Chris Evans as Captain America, and we watch Robert Downey Jr. as Iron Man, you know, Mark Ruffalo as the Hulk. They're adult characters. I find it perplexing that they haven't said, you know what, we're making films for teenage audiences, but we don't have a teenage character to really get behind. They're all adults. They've all lived a life, and surely that's going to be good. Like, surely that's going to be good for the franchise moving forward, for the larger Marvel Universe moving forward. In a lot of ways, it could be like a Harry Potter, where the storyline grows with its audience as well. And and the character ages and gets to a point as well, if it's successful. And I guess both of you have brought up, you know, the issues that exist with that, is that this is the third iteration of a Spider-Man character. If they don't get it right this time, I don't know if he's coming back. And it would be a darn shame if he didn't, because he's one of the most compelling real characters that exists inside of the Marvel comic book universe.
Well, I mean, the first trilogy was a pretty big success. You know, they made a successful trilogy. And I thought Sam Raimi did a pretty good job. I'm not the world's biggest Tobey Maguire fan, but, you know, I thought it was really clever to get Sam Raimi to direct it, who has a bit of a, you know, a schlock horror background, similar to what James Gunn has with, you know, Guardians of the Galaxy and things like that. He was a good choice, and I thought he was able to bring a bit of his sense of humor to it as a little bit of irreverence. The third film had some flaws, but it definitely delivered with some big set pieces, and that's what you'd want from the third installment. So I found it very perplexing when they rebooted it so quickly. And that, you know, obviously thinking, oh, there's something we can do different, there's something we can do better. It didn't, you know, they didn't get to a third movie.
I don't think they thought that at all. I think they thought there's more money to be made. Yeah. We don't need to do...
No, look.
Because they didn't do it better or more interesting. Yeah, they or they were like, there are other characters here that we can delve into in the Spidey universe. Let's delve into them and bank.
He's a character that is a superhero that has a job. A shitty job. And that's what people want. In the same way that the X-Men franchise pushed the idea that, you know, the disenfranchised youth of the world had a vehicle through the X-Men. It's like people who weren't accepted. Like, that was the whole shtick of what was going on there. You know, as far as, again, as far as parallels are concerned between mutants and people that don't fit in, you know, like, that's something that's not going to go away. They're always going to try and mine that because there's always going to be people that are in that scenario. You know, you're working hard to get by, trying to balance everything that exists in your life. That formula exists everywhere. And if there's a superhero that's trying to adhere to that as well, I mean, they'd be mad not to do that because they're the people that are paying, you know, 11, 15 bucks, whatever it is, to sit, you know, bums on seats inside of cinemas going, oh, someone, you know, there's a character there that I can actually relate to.
But for me, though, everything you're saying with the shitty job and all the, you know, all the qualities that makes him an interesting character, I thought that was captured pretty well in three films. I guess what I want to know is, what are they going to do this time that is really going to justify it, other than rebooting him to weave him into this crossover universe they've established? Is that really the only reason?
Well, I tell you what, there's something that is worth bringing up as an aside, and I'm sorry to interrupt you guys, but we have long been told the Donald Glover is going to be a part of this film. Now, Donald Glover does not appear in this first trailer, and I don't think he's such a massive, massive star that it's like, oh, what a surprise it'll be when Donald turns up. We know he's coming. We know he's going to be in it. Why isn't Donald Glover in this trailer?
I have a theory about that, but look, this is speculation purely.
Indulge us, please.
So, inside of the Marvel comic book universe, there exists a straight continuity, which is the Marvel 616 world, which is pretty much where most of the comic book stuff that you know and love is based. But they've introduced a variety of different realities that exist with same characters, but, you know, they might be different people. There's different conflicts that exist inside of their universe. And for the better part of the last 20 years, there's been crossovers where some of the characters have come over. In fact, right now, the current Marvel comic book timeline, Wolverine's dead. There's a version of Old Man Logan, which I guess will be interesting moving forward as well, because we have the film Logan coming out, which we believe that character is based on. He's come over to the central universe, the straight line universe, from another reality. There's also another Spider-Man called Miles Morales. He's a African-American Spidey, and he has jumped over before. Now, knowing that that exists and knowing what's happened with the Doctor Strange film, where we've found a new Infinity Stone, which is, you know, the reality stone, as it were, there is room to move now that they could create a crossover where perhaps Miles, or maybe Donald Glover, comes over to this universe as another Spider-Man. And what that opens up, as far as a commercial sense for the Marvel comic books franchise, is phenomenal. Because if you think about it, it means that any character that exists right now, all the big ones, your Chris Evans as Captain America, your Mark Ruffalo as the Hulk, your Robert Downey Jr., who's banking huge bucks as Iron Man, they could get new people. They could just come over from a different reality. And that means that the continuation of the characters could be endless.
So we've got a potentially endless Marvel universe, based on the, Well,
it's very convenient.
Yeah. Very convenient and very bankable. But,
I just sound like a cynic.
But it's something I guess we'll have to keep our eye on. And I guess we'll find out what happens with it when we see the next trailer, or I guess when we see Spider-Man Homecoming. Stay tuned for part 3 of Coming Attractions.
Sure. Welcome back to Coming Attractions. Now, we do try to stay in touch with what's happening on our Facebook. And this week we were asked a question by Perry. And he said to us, why is the balance of Western and sci-fi so hard to get right? For example, Westworld is great. That's the TV show. Cowboys and Aliens was shit. Firefly was great, but unable to get mainstream success. So it's an interesting question, guys. I mean, there hasn't been lots and lots of sci-fi Western films made. Why do you think it is hard to get that balance right?
No, you go.
All right, why not? It's, well, obviously to begin with, you've got what seem to be very stark different worlds.
Yeah.
You know, how do you go from alien planets to what is a very firmly rooted idea of this time and place in America? And to be fair, you know, there have been Westerns that are set in different locations, but the idea that they are so separate, however, that also does, you know, lend to the fact that, well, it should be easy to bring them together. Not easy, but, you know, they, you know, two different things, you bring them together and you see what happens. And I think Perry raised some really good and interesting examples of ones that have gone well and ones that have not. And I guess my easy answer, and again, he already flagged that it doesn't always work, but it's that when you've got something like Cowboys and Aliens, well, it's right there in the title, Cowboys and Aliens. It's a Western and a sci-fi versus a Western sci-fi, something that's managed to meld the two together really well. Now, the problem with my obvious insight is that Firefly was a fantastic amalgamation of the two that didn't get mainstream success. And I guess the best example of a successful sci-fi cowboy has got to be Han Solo.
100%. Look, to be honest with you, I think it's the balance between cowboy and sci-fi. And, you know, scripting, you know, the ensemble cast, what's happening there obviously play big parts, but I mean, they play big parts in everything. I don't, you know, you could use that across anything. I think it's comes down to the creators of the show need to make a very strong decision off the bat as to where they want it to live. For example, Firefly, there's sci-fi elements, but really it's a cowboy thing. You know, like they fly in, you know, mechanical ships around, you know, the universe and do things like that, but it still just feels like a Western to me. And that's why it has garnered critical acclaim, even though it got canned perhaps before its time. You have to choose. That's what I would say. Like, you have to make a decision, say, we can't just, you know, sit in that middle ground, sit on the fence and get splinters in the bum, as it were, when you put together something like this. You have to say, either we're here with a little bit of this or we're here with a little bit of this. So that's what I would say.
I think the original Westworld film, Michael Crichton's film, was a great flick because the concept was strong. It was a concept which seamlessly brought the two together. And I think it comes down to the concept. Cowboys and Aliens was pretty straightforward. It was just, let's set it in, you know, on the frontier and some aliens will arrive. And that film, unfortunately, just didn't reach any great peak, really. It had some big set pieces, but yeah, generally, I don't think really amazed anyone. Of course, Back to the Future 3 is something of an example as well. And Wild Wild West, which I quite enjoyed as a kid. I remember seeing that at the movies. We probably laugh about it now. But
I'm glad you grew up. That's all I'm going to say, because I'll tell you what.
It was more of a steampunk thing as well, specifically. It wasn't hard sci-fi.
It did
crossover.
Have a lot of that, yeah.
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 There's a great interview with Kevin Smith where he talks about having written the script for Superman. I believe it was called Superman Flyby. And he worked with this producer who owned the script, or was, you know, was in charge of the film. And he said, listen, you need to have a spider. A spider needs to be your bad guy at the end, because spiders are terrifying and they mess stuff up. And anyway, the whole film got shelved and whatever else happened. And Kevin Smith sort of, you know, makes the observation that 2-3 years later, this same producer is in charge of Wild Wild West. And at the very end, you've got this steampunk spider that comes along. Yeah. It's the ultimate.
I remember this story. He's like, just in the third act, there has to be a giant mechanical spider. He's like, how does Superman fit into that scenario? It doesn't make it. He was like, he can't fly as well. Because, you know, you can't have Superman flying.
And I think it was a direct quote. He can't wear red and blue as his Superman suit because it's, quote, faggy.
He was actually a celebrity hairdresser as well before he became Barbara a producer. Streisand's hairdresser. I know. It's like, so he's running the show now? Like, I mean, maybe.
Oh, you know, it's one of my favorite Kevin Smith quotes, because in Hollywood, you fail up.
100%. Look, in a more serious tone, I suppose, we have a bit of a shout out as well tonight, Joe. I understand you want to take the helm on this one.
We received some really sad news this week that one of the great friends of the local film and movie scene here in the Hunter passed away. Norma McDonough, who has been at the helm of the Video Easy franchises in our area for as long as we've been.
100%.
Yeah, and I mean, it's one thing for us to discuss films that we saw at the cinema, but our love for film came about because we went to Video Easy and we went and got the movie guarantee and
$6 weeklies. Yeah, yeah.
It was 10 weeklies for $10. Anyway,
that's where it started for me, I suppose, in a lot of ways. You know, like we would, you know, I'm sure a lot of parents did this as well. You know, we had something on. We'll get a couple of weeklies. If I was lucky, I've been behaved. Maybe a new release as well. And and I'd sit down and you know, watch what had come out, I guess. And that was, for, I guess, a lot of people now, they wouldn't really vibe off that because it's such a digital realm. But for me, it was such an important thing, you know? Like the idea that you could get a hold of a film in a time where internet wasn't a thing yet and digital downloads wasn't a thing yet. It's a pretty pivotal element. And she'll be sorely missed. Yeah, you know?
Absolutely. Gave me my first job at Video Easy. Really helped to I guess fuel my love for film was working there, and she was good enough to just give me a summer job when I was at boarding school. You know, a really friendly, lovely, compassionate woman who had a great love of film, and she'll be, as you say, very sorely missed, and our condolences, of course, go out to her wonderful family, Gary, her husband, and her four amazing kids, Dan, Matt, Sam, and Gabby, who, we hope you guys are doing okay.
100%. For me, it kind of feels a lot like when some of the cinemas went down in parts of, I guess, the city CBD as well. For me, that it resonates in that way, and that was sad because a lot of those places were running foreign films and running limited release films as well. And whilst that's starting to come back now, there was a better part of a decade where, you know, you would go to see Hollywood blockbusters, and that was pretty much it. And that's a sad way to do things. And, you know, like there's something about, which we should all remember as well, about going to a video store and having this library of pretty much anything that you want to see. And whilst, yes, that does exist on the internet now, there's something amazing about having that tangible quality to be able to walk through a place and pick things up and look at the covers. And in the same way that, I guess, there's a resurgence of records now and things like that, I think people are getting back on board, not necessarily for the sound, but just for the cover art. Look, there's things that exist with a physical copy of something that you cannot reproduce. And she was a purveyor of that. And she'll be sorely missed.
Well, on that sad note, we're going to wrap up for this week of coming attractions. We will be back a number of occasions this week. It's a pretty big week with a certain film in a certain franchise, in a certain universe, in a certain galaxy,
far, far, far away.
So we will absolutely be back on a little bit of a different schedule this week, and be sure to tune in. Check us out on our Facebook page, on our Twitter, and we've also got Snapchat now. Wait, no, Instagram, the other one. All these things that I don't
just
know about.
Get on the social media.
Yeah, the social
have
medias.
A look. We're there.
Yep. Yeah. Mum and Dad.
Tell me you don't want to see these mugs. iTunes.
iTunes, yep. Exactly.
Listen to us on iTunes.
Yeah. Mm. We'll see you during the week.